sir?
Doing well, doing
Hi, everyone. You're in the Bring It On track. And next up, we have our panel here with Ask the EFF. We have Kurt Opsahl and Andrew Crocker, who are both attorneys for the EFF. So here to answer your questions and provide some insights. So take it away.
All right, thank you. Thank you for coming, everybody. We're always glad to come back to Shmoocon for this opportunity to tell you a little bit about what we've been doing and get your questions. My name is Kurt Opsahl. I'm the Deputy Executive Director and General Counsel with the Electronic Frontier Foundation. And my colleague?
I'm Andrew Crocker. I'm a staff attorney. I work on the Civil Liberties team at EFF.
And so what we're going to do, we'll give you a little bit of the year in review, what happened last year in our space, and then a little bit of discussion of looking forward, what we're going to do to try and protect the future. So for those, probably most of you know who the Electronic Frontier Foundation is, but for those who don't, we are a member-supported nonprofit organization that is dedicated to defending your rights online. We do this through a couple of means. We have attorneys who try and take cases, make precedent, and work through the court system to effect change. We have activists who work to gather grassroots support, get people motivated, contacting their representatives, working to build support for good policies. And we have our technologists who create freedom-enhancing software and distribute that open source and for free to help protect people through their computers. And we're trying to do this. We've been doing this since 1990 with some successes and some challenges remaining. One of the things that EFF did in its early days, what was called the crypto wars of the 1990s, and for a while we thought that had been won in the sense that a lot of bad crypto proposals were withdrawn, and what turned out to be sort of a lull instead. And the crypto wars have come back, so we're now in the middle of crypto wars part two. This has been an interesting year for that. Mostly good news, actually, on crypto. There's been a lot of threats to it, but several bad bills were proposed and didn't go forward. There was the Apple iPhone case. As many of you probably recall, this was when the FBI wanted to get into Apple's computer and not a computer, a phone that was used by the San Bernardino attacker, the security on the phone wouldn't let them in, at least not without some additional effort. So they went to Apple to try to get a court to order Apple to let them in. And what this really meant was ordering Apple to rewrite its operating system to disable some security functions. In particular, they wanted to reduce the time limit on password attempts, have an unlimited number of password attempts, and allow for electronic password attempts so that they could brute force their way into the system. This raised a lot of very very important questions, not just for Apple, but just how the law and the government interacts with technology, because it's one thing to ask a company to, you know, provide some records they have or provide some assistance within the confines of the technology that they produce, and another thing to have somebody rewrite their software to disable security functions. Basically putting in a government back door telling the companies how they can code things. So that case was ongoing and coming to a hearing when just the night before the hearing. It was delayed. The government said we found a way that might let us into the phone independently. Eventually, the hearing was canceled when it turned out the government had purchased a exploit and gotten into the phone without Apple's assistance.
Some of us were already in Southern California waiting for the hearing to start.
Yeah, I found out, like, I was on my way to the airport. Thankfully, I was able to find out before I got in the plane.
But I was already there.
A little bit last minute.
Yeah.
But what this also means is that right now, there isn't a very strong precedent. There is one precedent, a different case out of Brooklyn, New York, where they were similarly trying to get Apple to allow access to an iPhone. In that case, it was a drug dealer's phone. Alleged drug dealer. Actually, I think he was convicted. They managed to convict him anyway. That had happened in the fall of 2015. The judge there said, you know what, I'm not sure that you really have this authority. Could you give me some more briefing on the authority you claim to have? The government claimed the All Writs Act. As authority in the All Writs Act is a 1789 era law. It is not obviously having anything to do with like technology because they didn't really think about that at the time. It's more just a general enabling act to allow courts to issue orders in furtherance of the jurisdiction they already have. I mean, it's very straightforward enhancement of their powers, but gets to be used in not straightforward ways. In any event, the court eventually determined that no, the government didn't have that power. The All Writs Act didn't provide them with that authority. The government was appealing that decision when they were able to get on into the phone independently and then withdrew their appeal. So there's sort of a precedent, but it's at the lowest possible level of the court system, and it's not binding on any other court. If they had gone through with the appeal, we would have had sort of a greater precedent. So that's going to be a fight that's ongoing, but we'll have to wait to see what the next case comes forward if the government continues to push the All Writs Act theory. And at the same time, this led to some legislative responses. There was Senators Burr and Feinstein came out with a bill called the Compliance with Court Orders Act. In direct reference to that, but it really was the Mandatory Backdoor Act. It was actually really, really poorly written, so that even if you agreed with its purposes, it wasn't actually good at achieving those. And then also it did a number of things that would be like ending computers as we know it. So this was withdrawn and generally, I think, considered to be a bad idea, but they may come back with more. So that's sort of on the positive side. These bad things didn't happen, and some good things did happen in encryption, which is massive deployment. One of the projects that EFF contributes to is called Let's Encrypt. I guess familiar with this as a certificate authority, and it gives you free certificates to everybody. Thank you. Yeah, it is a great project, and it has been tremendously successful. I believe, as of the last time we were looking at it, some 20 million sites were getting encrypted through this, this number continues to rise. I saw some metrics on the number of encrypted sites out there, and last year, for the first time, 50% of websites being seen through the Chrome and Firefox browsers were being over encrypted connections. And two-thirds if you count it by the amount of time spent on a page. So the most popular sites were generally getting encryption. So that is a good start. There's a lot more to go. 50% is only halfway there, but we can keep going on that. Last point on encryption. There is some bad news. In the UK, they passed the Investigatory Powers Act, often called the Snooper's Charter. This is a surveillance law that covers a wide variety of additional surveillance powers for the UK government. But sort of pressing on this issue, it has a provision about technical assistance notices. And so the Home Secretary can give these technical assistance notices and require companies or providers to remove any encryption that they might have put on. So it kind of suggests that the UK government says you have to have the ability to remove the encryption if you are asked to do so, which kind of is suggesting you have to have a back door. It hasn't really been put to the test yet, but it will be interesting. Another interesting provision of this bill, or this law now, is that it wants companies to preview products before they go to market with the UK government. And it also says that the UK government has jurisdiction over everybody in the world. So it's not limited to the United Kingdom. Apparently the sun doesn't set on their bad crypto policy. So we'll see how that law comes about because it just got passed through. Let's see. A couple other things to talk about. One, this actually harkens back to 2015 when there was the DMCA exemption process every 3 years. The Digital Millennium Copyright Act has a process by which you can ask to be exempted from its provisions. And the DMCA has a provision that is designed to prevent people from circumventing copyright protection, put some heavy penalties if you're doing that. And one of the exemptions sought in 2015 was a security researcher exemption to allow people to do that circumvention when they are engaged in good faith security research. But yeah, it was a good thing. But there was one weird thing about it. For the bulk of its provisions, they said, but you have to wait a year. So 12 months after it was published is when the exemption would go into effect. And these exemptions only last 3 years, so you only got it for 2 out of the 3 years. But the good news is 12 months has passed, and so we now have the 1201 exemption for security, good faith security research, which is good. This is good stuff. The other 1201 news is that we are challenging the whole statute. So it is basically a statute that you know, tells people what they can research, what they can publish. It has sort of tremendous implications on people exercising their First Amendment freedoms. And it is, in essence, a government licensing scheme. So we have filed a suit to challenge that scheme and have that process be reviewed by a court to see if it complies. So hopefully we can actually knock out the system or at least get it substantially improved through that lawsuit. Let's see what else we have here. Why don't we turn it over to you?
Sure.
Andrew, and hit a couple of things you've been working on?
Yeah, and just to underscore, you know, we're happy to take questions about anything that EFF works on, although we're just two lawyers, so we can only do our best to answer as lawyers do. And I would really recommend reading our blog, which is a thing that people say, but we publish a stupid amount of content. And it's all very good, and I say that as somebody who writes a tiny fraction of it. I can't keep up with it. I'm sure everyone else can't. But, I would, look at our year in review series. There's 26 posts. We're covering a tiny, tiny fraction of what we did this last year. But just to hit on a couple of things that might be of interest to this audience, you may have heard about the changes to Rule 41. This is the rule of criminal procedure that governs in the federal courts and determines how warrants are issued for the government to search or seize information, property, people, and so on. There was a change proposed by the Justice Department, and it ended up going into effect in December. And the way this is supposed to work is it's supposed to be just the rules of the road, the procedure by which warrants are issued. So it's not supposed to be super controversial. But in this particular case, the change to the rule allows the government to do what it calls, or what the rule calls, remote access. to search information when certain conditions are satisfied, and those conditions are when the target that's being searched, target computer, has obscured its location through so-called technological means, or if there's a series of computers located in five or more judicial districts where there's damage to a computer or violation of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. And seemingly in plain English, what this means is it allows the government to get a warrant to hack into computers remotely when those computers are either in unknown places or if there's a botnet. And that botnet includes hacking into the victims of the botnet, so not necessarily the command and control computers or the people running the botnet, but the individual nodes in the botnet. And they can apply for this warrant anywhere where the crime has some element. So in many internet crimes, that's everywhere, universal, or in many, many districts in the country. This has been a pretty controversial change to the rules. EFF thought that it was a bad idea that it would allow, forum shopping, sort of going to the judge that's most favorable to this kind of application, and allow the FBI to sort of engage in mass hacking without developing really clear rules of the road for what it looks like when the government wants to, remotely access and take over a computer, look for information stored on it. That's a very invasive kind of search. So we did our best to try to stop it. There were two delay bills that were introduced by friends in Congress, Ron Wyden and others, the Stop Mass Hacking Act and the Stop Mass Damaging Hacking Act, or SMH and SMDH acts. So they got to have a little fun with the acronyms. Neither of those worked, so the rule went into effect in December. That's the rules of the road. We think it's something to be pretty concerned about, because it's really one of the first times that there's been an acknowledgement that the government engages in hacking in the law, and this is something that, of course, has been going on for a very long time. We all know that, and we think that there needs to be far more transparency about what kind of operations the government is engaging in, what their capabilities are, and develop very clear rules, because this is such an invasive technique. One other thing to mention is we've been doing a lot of work on national security letters. These are administrative subpoenas issued by the FBI to service providers, telecom and internet providers. What makes them particularly notable is that they come with gag orders that potentially in perpetuity say you can't tell anyone you got this gag order, that you got this request for information about your customers. You can't even say you got five of them, you have to say you got between, at this point, 0 and 499 of them, or different permutations. This is a pretty direct infringement on the free speech of the providers, who want to be transparent with their customers, want to let their customers know when the government is asking about them. So we've been suing about this for a long time, and that continues. But we had a couple of sort of victories along the way. We represented the Internet Archive, which received an NSL over the summer, and successfully pointed out that the text of the letter that they sent to the Internet Archive was incorrect. They got the law wrong. The FBI responded, said, okay, you Internet Archive can publish this letter, and in fact we will change the text of the letter that we've been sending out. And by our calculations, probably sent out thousands or even tens of thousands of them with an incorrect description of the law. So resulted in a fairly significant change in how the FBI is issuing NSLs. Also, our two clients that we've been suing, making a constitutional challenge against the NSL statute for many years, they both had gags lifted and are able to reveal that they have received, in one case, two NSLs, and another case, one NSL, and they are Credo Mobile, a provider of telecommunication services, and Cloudflare, the web enhancement and security firm. And as I said, those cases continue. We will have a hearing coming in March, and we'll still be arguing that the statute is unconstitutional, but it's been a year of progress of sort of selective transparency on NSLs, and so it's worth recognizing that we're slowly chipping away at them. So just turning to what we're going to be doing in the future and what we're calling protecting tomorrow, sort of, you can imagine we've been getting asked a lot about what we're going to do after the election, to which we have sort of two sets of answers. One is we're going to do the same thing that we always have done, what we've been doing since 1990, as Kurt described it. We're a civil liberties organization. Civil liberties are nonpartisan things. We have sued every administration that's been in office in our time. We sued the Bush administration over warrantless wiretapping. We been suing the Obama administration over the sort of evolutions of the NSA's programs over the 1201 rulemaking procedure, as Kurt was describing, and the Trump administration will inherit all of those lawsuits, and they will, you know, when Jeff Sessions is confirmed, if he's confirmed, he will be the defendant in a lawsuit against the FBI, just as Loretta Lynch is the current defendant in that lawsuit. We also recognize that people have specific concerns about things that the Trump administration has promised to do during the campaign, and so our particular expertise is in talking to technology companies, working with folks like you, and so we're sort of thinking about how we can we can strengthen user protection. So we, as sort of one example, we took out a big ad in the last issue of Wired aimed at the tech companies, giving them a list of things they can do. Further roll out HTTPS, as Kurt was talking about, delete logs if they don't need it. You can't be forced to turn over information you don't have. Speak up if they get requests that they don't like. So fight against these gag orders. We may have heard about Yahoo getting this really, at least in the way it was described in the press, crazy sounding request to scan all incoming email. We would hope that companies, if they're given requests like that, do everything they can to inform us, the public, about that and fight it. And then again, sort of standing up in court. So like our friends at Credo, Cloudflare, the Internet Archive, come talk to us if you get one of these orders. We will do our best to challenge it. We're also trying to build bridges to other organizations that are working with targeted communities. We're not trying to substitute for their work, but we do have some expertise that we can share on security training. We have our surveillance self-defense guide that we've been working on and will continue to build, sort of aimed at protesters, lawyers, journalists, students, and so on. And we will continue to work at the state level. We've made some significant progress on state legislation. In California, for instance, we have what's called CalECPA, requiring a warrant for all communications and in location information and so on. It's a sort of a gold standard for this kind of bill, and we can continue to work on those things. There's a lot that we can do at the state level, even if we're not as hopeful as we once were about Congress and the executive branches. I think with that, maybe we'll take questions, and we have a major caveat, which is this is not a good forum to ask for legal advice in because it's not confidential. We're happy to talk to you afterwards if you think you might need to talk to a lawyer, but we can certainly answer general questions about the law and EFF's work.
So we have the microphone there, so line up by the mic, and we'll take the questions one at a time. Keep in mind that this is being streamed, so your questions are not just going to be limited to this audience, but anyone who comes along see that. So as to echo what Andrew just said, this is not the time for confidential information to come out, but we're happy to take your general questions. So, sir.
Early publications on the voting machines, there's been a legitimate concern for the level of security of voting machines and accumulator tabulators. We do need to do something about that collectively. But the other side of the coin is the recent declaration by the Secretary of Homeland Security that voting systems and machines are critical infrastructure. And I personally am worried about the intrusion of a central single federal government control over all elections. And my question is that critical infrastructure issue at least on the radar of EFF to keep an eye on as it moves forward?
So we've been working on voting system security for a while, often in the context of representing researchers who have wanted to look into voting machines and or get information about them, and sometimes the voting machine manufacturers didn't like that as much, and also on pushing for a voter verified paper trail to allow for the audit capacity, which is very important because even the sort of the best of electronic voting machines could be subject to an attack. And if you don't audit it against the paper trail, you don't know if it is. As you guys probably saw, there were some auditing done over this last election in Wisconsin. There was an audit, and there were attempts at auditing as well in Michigan and Pennsylvania, though those audits were not complete. They were stopped before they finished. And in a couple of cases where there were tight elections elsewhere, there were some attempts at auditing, though in some cases, the local agency who was doing the audit of an e-voting machine, which did have a paper trail, felt that their auditing job had been complete by just looking over the electronic totals a second time without doing the comparison, which does defeat the point of having the paper trail. One of the strongest defenses that we have against an attack trying to change vote totals is the decentralization of our system, is because it's generally done at the county level with a wide variety of different figures, different systems. It requires, therefore, just an exponentially more challenging attack to have enough of a difference to really swing something. So on the one hand, like that is actually an important part of the defense, and if everything gets centralized, we would lose that. On the other hand, you know, one of the problems why we got into the e-voting issue in the first place was after some of the problems with hanging chads and such in the 2000 election, there was the Help America Vote Act, which is sort of a very strange thing from the government, because it was a funded lack of mandate. Usually they like to give the unfunded mandate, but in this case, it was providing money to buy e-voting systems without any real standards for what those systems should be. And this led to enterprising voting machine manufacturers to get things out there quickly, get the contracts, and have security be job, you know, five or six after a lot of other things. So I think there could be some value in having minimum standards that machines need to have. Whether that is best coming from the government, or is it best coming from the many academics who have looked deeply at the issue. The key is to make sure that those are well thought through standards that will actually make the machines auditable and as secure as they possibly can be.
So that was my concern of the critical infrastructure declaration being a camel's nose for potential full centralization.
And so I have heard that happened, but so far I've not seen what they are doing besides making the designation. So we'll see what they do and whether it's a problem.
Thank you.
Hi. Earlier you mentioned the government doing basically shopping around for judges who would be sympathetic to their cause, as far as wanting surveillance or particular orders of investigatory powers. Mm-hmm. Are there any particular jurisdictions which are notably bad for that, or is there like areas where they look towards to get things pushed through?
So one of the things that makes answering that kind of question very hard is that by nature these things are often secret or just obscure. So it's not like there are comprehensive statistics on warrant applications that are, and where they're turned down or approved more often than not. There's been some academic work on that, but it's not, it's not comprehensive, and it's impeded by the secrecy of these proceedings in general. However, there's a little more backstory to the Rule 41 changes that I was talking about. It was directly inspired by an operation the FBI ran, where they took over a torrent service that was hosting some massive amounts of child pornography, and they were operating this Tor hidden service, the government was, and then serving the visitors with malware. And in order to do that, they got a warrant to serve the malware to all the visitors. They got a single warrant. And they got that warrant out of the Eastern District of Virginia, which is where the FBI is located, and they did that because they were operating the facility where they were operating it was located there. And they, so they, you know, they had the jurisdiction, the venue for it because of that. So, you know, it's sometimes said that, that there might be specific venues where, you know, that's sort of home court for the FBI. I don't think that's totally fair, but the sort of upshot of the rule change is that it's very easy to go to a particular venue, whereas before there had to be a closer nexus and a specific reason why that judge sitting in that particular venue would be able to issue that warrant.
And let me just add to that a little bit. In the iPhone case, I mean, they had a nexus to the two different jurisdictions. So the Brooklyn drug dealer case was a, you know, Brooklyn-based drug dealer, and San Bernardino case, it was in the Central District of California, where the county of San Bernardino is, where those attacks occurred. And then once they're in the jurisdiction, you know, they randomly get assigned a judge. And Judge Orenstein out in Brooklyn actually has a bit of a history of challenging the government's expansive views of the law, has written some pretty thorough opinions, and is actually a little not surprising that he put them to the test. And, you know, so maybe from their point of view, it was just bad luck to get that particular judge on it. But we don't know how many other times they've gotten a judge in these jurisdictions and you know, out of secret order, and there it is. And I think that it's not just about judge shopping. In that case, it is also sort of noteworthy that the facts are very different. I mean, even though the legal issue is similar, when you're going to a judge and you're talking to them about a terrorist attack and you know, an item of you know, horrific details of what their crime was, and you're asking to get on the phone, it puts a lot more to the case. So, you know, they did start out, the FBI Director Comey started out saying it wasn't about creating a precedent, but eventually, actually, he was testifying before Congress, and under questioning, it said, yes, actually, it was about creating a precedent.
Hey, I have a question. I think maybe last night or the night before, I read about the Obama administration making a rule change that allows the NSA to share unminimized data with the FBI. And I guess prior to this rule change, they had to minimize information about US persons. This seems like a huge deal to me. So my first question is it a big deal? And the second question is, do you have any idea why they would do this right before they leave and a new administration that they're not even really friendly with is coming in? Why do you think they would change that? Thanks.
So I think that whether these particular rules are a big deal or not is maybe a harder question than the, you know, one step backward, which is where this data is coming from. And it's collected under Executive Order 12333, which generally governs the collection of signals intelligence outside of the United States and is largely ungoverned by other law. So this is the authority by which the NSA has been conducting a lot of its sort of most expansive programs. So when you heard about through the Snowden documents, tapping into the fiber optic cables that connected different data centers in Google and other companies, that was ostensibly done under 12333. The hacking into the SIM card manufacturers, that's also done under 12333. And these are sort of the least constrained programs of the NSA's activities. And so I think, you know, we would like to see far more oversight of operations under 12333. The Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board, which is sort of the independent agency that was set up after 9/11 to look into these sorts of things, was in the process of doing a full review of 12333. Less than full review of 12333, and that's apparently delayed. So, you know, I think we need far more oversight of those activities. As far as these particular rules, I've heard different accounts of why they finalized it on the way out. They're sort of the more charitable interpretation is that it helps to have final rules and that these were in the works for a long time. And so at least we have sort of rules of the road, even if the previous ones might have been preferable. I don't know how much credence to give that. It's really hard to say. These kinds of agency protocols are really no substitute for, you know, clear laws from Congress and you know, interpretations of the Fourth Amendment that protect our rights. And you know, that's kind of, I think, our main goal, whether these agency protocols are good enough or not. I don't know if you want to add to that.
I mean, yeah, I think it is a pretty important thing. And it also is a good reminder of the sort of the flip side to this, which is that under Section 702 of the USA Freedom Act, the government can get information from service providers when they're looking for a particular target, but they get to sift through a lot of information and may end up collecting a whole bunch of information incidentally about U.S. persons. So together, these two sides of the coin mean that there is a tremendous amount of information that is being collected about people who were not the direct targets, and some of the justification for doing this would, you know, otherwise seem pretty invasive. Say, well, but you know, well, it's very important for national security. But then if you tend to take the same information and turn around and use it for general criminal investigations, it's sort of pulling the rug out from under that justification and brings it a lot more close to the kind of general warrant that the British government was using against the American colonists that was part of some of the reasons for our revolution and for the Fourth Amendment in the first place. I say that the founding fathers didn't fight a revolution for you know, good protocols. They wanted to stop the government overreach.
Hi, I was wondering regarding the NSLs with the incorrect language. How much does that lower the bar to other recipients of NSLs historically coming out and talking about, well, getting their gag orders lifted, fighting that, and otherwise potentially gaining some public knowledge of how many NSLs have been served to date that may have had that incorrect information?
So the specific incorrect language in the letter was about how often the provider is allowed to make a challenge. It used to be that you were limited to one a year after receiving the letter, and now since the USA Freedom Act of 2015, you're not limited to one a year, you can do whenever. So it's a fairly technical thing that they got wrong, but I think the bigger point is that receiving an NSL is a, you know, can be a scary, intimidating thing. You're issued this gag order and you're told not to challenge it, and that it would harm national security even to say that you got this. I think that providers are discouraged for various reasons, that being one of them, relationships with the government, sort of historical practice of these things from challenging them at all. With that said, there's nothing stopping them from asking the government to lift the gag or going to court themselves. And you know, they can do that now. They could have done that before. We only know about a handful of times when that's happened, several of them because EFF was involved in helping the clients, a few others through the ACLU or between ACLU and EFF. But we're talking about a total of, you know, 10 to 15 NSLs out of what we know is something like 600,000 that have been issued since 9/11, since the Patriot Act expanded NSLs. USA Freedom also has this provision that requires the FBI to reevaluate NSLs that it served at appropriate intervals to see if the gag order is still necessary. And it doesn't say what appropriate intervals are or what they're required to do once they do it at the appropriate intervals. So the FBI put out some procedures for doing that last year, or end of 2015. And they do it twice over the course of the lifetime of NSL, when the investigation closes and at the three-year mark of the investigation. But as a court that looked at this said, there's some loopholes to that. If the investigation never closes, they don't have to do that one. And if they decide at the three-year mark, no, we still need the gag order, then we've got a perpetual gag order, and we've fulfilled our obligations to reevaluate this at so-called appropriate intervals. And of course, that's the FBI doing it, not a court. So the FBI may have some thumb on the scales if they are the ones issuing the gag order in the first place. So this is all to say that there is a procedure in place for reviewing all these gags, or some portion of them at least, but it's really insufficient, and it sort of doesn't substitute for what we think the right way of stopping the publication of information in advance is, which is to meet a very, very high standard under the First Amendment. In general, courts are very reluctant to say to people who receive information, you can't talk about it, or you can't talk about the fact that you received this NSL. There's only very limited circumstances under the law, and we think that the NSL statute just flies far short of that. So we hope that recipients will recognize that and start to speak up. And we are seeing more transparency. Google, Yahoo, the Internet Archive, Credo, Cloudflare, these are all in the last 6 months that these companies and organizations have been able to say that they received NSLs. So, chipping away very slowly.
Great, thank you. Yeah.
Hey, so we've had a lot of conversation about privacy, and I appreciate that. It was good conversation. One of the other things that concerns me, though, over the next 4 years is, media companies, internet, ISPs, constant efforts to roll back net neutrality, achieving some more success. Can you talk at all about the EFF's plans and way forward on advocating for net neutrality?
Sure. So net neutrality has been an important issue, it had seemed like after a lot of back and forth, we'd sort of come to a good resting point. Just to highlight some of the challenges with net neutrality is that it is a good place to be, where people are not taking advantage of their place in the system to advantage or disadvantage other players. Has been tremendously useful for the growth of the internet, that people can operate on relatively equal footing. However, the flip side is to regulate that and to make it happen requires giving some power to an agency that regulates it, and you have to worry about things like regulatory capture and whether you're going to be sort of giving too much power away. A rule went into place that attempted to balance that. It seemed like that would at least be the rule for the time being, but certainly that could change because our Mr. Trump has said very strongly he's opposed to net neutrality and wants to undo that. As the president can wield some tremendous power. So we're gonna have to see what he actually does on this. One of the challenges in preparing for this next administration is Trump seems to say more things than he does, or at least so far. So you can't be sure that any particular thing, even if very emphatically stated, is going to end up being really a focal point. I mean, just sort of to illustrate that in a completely different context, during the Apple iPhone thing, he called for a boycott of Apple, and then was continuing to tweet from his iPhone, and he did a Reddit AMA, had a photo op with that, showing he was using a Mac. It was like one thing to say it, but didn't seem to be actually particularly serious about the boycott. So I think he probably is more serious about the net neutrality, but is that going to be a priority, and where is that going to go? But it's something that we'll be looking at.
I have a question in regard to Ross Ulbricht and the Silk Road case, that the judge in the case seemed to deny Ross Ulbricht's Fourth Amendment rights because the data they collected against him was in a foreign country, and that he did not admit to actually that being his data. I just want to ask about the kind of precedent that would set.
So I'm not super familiar with the details of the case. My understanding is that there are some more complicated procedural elements that led to that ruling that exactly how he asserted his Fourth Amendment rights in the data and whether that was properly done or how it was asserted. But as I said, I'm not super familiar with it. In general, if you have Fourth Amendment rights, if you're a so-called U.S. person, those rights accompany you overseas, and you would have Fourth Amendment rights and data that you're holding outside of the United States. But this is at issue, of course, in a lot of the NSA's activities. They're not supposed to target U.S. persons, and they're supposed to have some confidence that the community.
Without going through some procedures, at least.
Without a warrant, I should say. And nevertheless, there's thousands or even millions of Americans' communications caught up in these warrantless wiretapping programs, and so there's clearly some difficulty in proving who has Fourth Amendment rights and in what time and in what information. I hope that sort of answers the question at least somewhat.
Yeah, a little bit. Thank you. Yeah.
Hi, thanks. I was wondering if you can comment on the playpen case. I know recently the FBI dropped some of the charges for that individual or made a motion to, instead of revealing some of their tactics or releasing any of the code on the NIT code. I know you guys have blogged about it and followed it. Is there any further development or is there going to be further pursuit, at least from the EFF's perspective, on trying to find out more about what the FBI is doing with this type of code? I know it certainly stretches into some of the things you talked about Fourth Amendment and Rule 41, but specifically around getting access to that code.
Yeah, so there are sort of two issues in the playpen cases. There's the, was the evidence acquired in a manner that violated the Fourth Amendment or not? And then there's this issue of access to the exploit that they used to acquire that data and whether that's material to the defense. There was this one case where the judge in the Western District of Washington ruled that the defense should have access to the exploit, that it was part of the chain that led to the acquisition of the evidence. And the government appealed that decision to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals and was sort of getting ready to brief it and then decided to voluntarily dismiss it. The same judge sort of subsequently went the other way in other cases. I mean, these playpen cases, there's a single warrant that's led to hundreds of prosecutions, so there's kind of inherently a risk of conflicting decisions. We have one judge who's actually reached the opposite conclusion in different cases. So it seems possible that the government is just playing a strategic game here and hoping that they won't have to go up on appeal and won't have to turn over the code. They've said that the code, first they said that the exploit code was not classified, but its discovery would lead to revelation of other material that was classified, and then they went ahead and classified the exploit itself. So from our perspective, they should be sort of put to a burden between the due process concerns of prosecuting people and letting them know the evidence against them and the national security type concerns that would lead them to withhold it. And I don't think those are fully compatible, but we kind of need a vehicle for challenging that, and there isn't an appeal right now, so we need a court to say, yes, this is material to your defense and it should be turned over.
Thank you everybody for coming. It's always great to come back here to Shmoocon. For those of you who missed the panel right before us, the Ask the Fed, they are sticking around. They stuck around for this panel, which is very kind of them. And we'll be also available to, so you're going up to the lounge to answer questions. So if you missed your opportunity before to ask the Fed, you still have it. And also thank you for coming to ask us some questions.
So just to let everyone know, we are wrapping up the track here. So take an hour for lunch and we'll be back up at 2 o'clock.